You know, I grew up in this town when I was 9 years old, and boy, Hollywood, what a town. It's not what a town today to me, but anyway, I want to tell you something. I worked with the Four Lads, the Supremes, and guess what? Today I am going to talk to Bill Courtney, one of the Four Esquires. Can you imagine Bill Courtney, you and I, the Four Esquires, 45 years ago?
45 years ago.
In Pennsylvania?
Pennsylvania.
God, can't believe it.
Wasn't it fun?
The Four Esquires. And my God, I haven't seen you. You look fantastic.
Thank you.
You're still writing. You're still singing. I can't believe it. You
Wonderful.
Look just great. Tell me about yourself. Growing up, really, where?
I was born in Portland, Maine.
Uh-huh.
My father was the United States Shipping Commissioner.
Right.
And he was transferred to Boston. And so naturally, we all moved to Boston.
So you lived in Boston?
Yes.
You know, I did a lot of Don DeCarlo. Wait, who's that guy there who used to book the weekends in Boston?
I think it was Don.
John and Sullivan. Yes. Johnny Sullivan.
Johnny Sullivan, right.
Yes.
Those club dates.
Those were great club dates. I used to work a lot around Massachusetts and Vermont. I loved it up there.
Worcester, Massachusetts.
Uh-huh.
Had a wonderful club there.
Yeah. So tell me about yourself. You went into the Army.
Into the Army. I signed when I was 17 so I could finish school because I would be 18 I could go in June.
Right,
I signed before. And I went in and I was went to gunnery school.
Uh-huh.
Beat 17 and beat 24, gunnery school, but I always sang.
But you were singing even in the Army.
When I went, the first day I was there, I met another soldier whose father was also in the Army, and he knew I sang. He said, wherever you go, whatever base, he said, the first thing you do, go to the entertainment office.
Always.
He said, it makes things easier.
And I did. Did all the shows. Tell me about working with the Kirby Stone Four. What is that all about?
Well, that was in the Army in San Diego. They had a band on the base.
Right.
And Saturday and Sundays, Friday and Saturday nights,
right.
We worked
you did
at the
Officers' Club. Right,
now,
of
his
course.
Name was not Kirby Stone. It was Herb Stone.
Herb Stone, okay.
The Herb Stone Orchestra. And he became famous. And he changed his name, and it was the Kirby Stone Four.
Uh-huh.
And also in the band was a guy named Jack Sims,
mm-hmm.
who became famous as Zoot Sims,
uh-huh.
a wonderful jazz musician.
But when did you return back from Boston after you got out of the Army?
Well, when I was when I was doing those shows, the CO of the base,
right.
liked my talent.
Right, right.
And he liked the songs I sang. So he made a connection in Hollywood, and he said, when I was separated from the service, I should go, and he would arrange for a screen test at Warner Brothers.
Uh-huh.
So I flew out here mm-hmm. from San Antonio. I stayed with my brother,
uh-huh.
and I called this person. His name was Selwyn Levinson,
mm-hmm.
who was some executive at Warner Brothers Pictures. And he had just been in an accident,
mm-hmm.
and he told me, he said, don't you read the papers? Yesterday,
uh-huh.
all the studios went on strike.
Mm.
And it lasted that was 1946, it lasted almost 6 months.
But
I waited about 2 weeks.
But
and then,
Jack Rose came in your life.
Jack Gold.
Joe, tell me about Jack Gold. That's who formed the Four Esquires.
That's right.
Tell me about that. How did that happen?
I went back to Boston.
Right.
And under the GI Bill, I went to the Berklee School of Music, and I studied there. So after I'd been there a couple of years, the owner who ran the place was, his name was Larry Burke. That's where he got the name Berkeley. And he said, I want you to meet somebody. And he said, this is Jack Gold, and he's a manager and record producer, and he is forming a vocal group, and they're looking for a baritone. So I sang for him, and anyway, I joined the group. I was working at a department store, and I left the group. We went to New York. The first thing we did, I was there 3 days. We went to Epic Records and we recorded From the Pajama Game. Let me see, was Steam Heat. And from there, somebody saw us and they said, you ought to try out for this show called Chance of a Lifetime. So we went there and we auditioned. We went on the show. We won, broke all the records, 7 weeks. And one of the quirks was that we got a week at the Latin Quarter, so we were there 7 weeks. And that was the beginning of our career. Wonderful.
So actually, the Latin Quarter really was the Four Esquires' beginning
of
the career.
That's right.
Then you went to the Town Hill in Buffalo. That's with Dick Roman. Dick Roman was on the Arthur Godfrey show. And this is the same thing happened to him. You get, after you win the Arthur Godfrey show, you go to the Latin Quarter. And that's where it all begins. I remember all that. Tell me about this Love Me Forever. That was your very, very first big hit.
That was our first top 10 hit. And it was our 13th record. And
That was a great song.
Yeah, it was. It hit top 10. And I think it hit number eight, somewhere. And that was a day when you could be on the charts for many, many weeks. And I think we were on the charts for almost 6 months. We hopped on, I think, at 53, and then it was 49, then 47.
I remember that Joni James, and Johnny Ray, and Johnny Mathis. They were all. But you worked on with Patti Page. Did a show with Patti Page.
The big record show.
Tell me about the big record show. The big record was Dick Clark show?
No.
What was that?
No, but this the big record was Patti Page, a big
Patti
variety.
Page.
You had to have a top 10 record.
She had her own show called The Big Record. Okay, I want to hear.
Doesn't have a shelf full of their own favorites. And if figures don't lie, a great many of those shelves have this next record right on the very top. So let's welcome the boys behind the big Paris record of Love Me Forever, the Four Esquires.
Love me.
looked over the Four Esquires. When you're looking at that right now, what goes through your mind? I mean, that's like 45 years ago. Come
on. It's 1958. 58. And it's just, it's a whole other life.
You know, you were the last group that ever hits, that was the last group ever hit the singles.
Pop.
A pop.
That's right.
Until rock and roll came in.
That's right. And no more Four Lads, no more
the
Ames cuts, Brothers.
The Ames Crew Cuts,
right.
The Four Lads, I worked with them all.
Yes, I know.
I worked with them all over the country, and I remember every one of them. They were just great. Mm-hmm. You guys had a certain style, every one of the groups, even
yes.
The Four Lads, the Crew Cuts, everyone.
Definitely.
Those days, people loved the Four.
Yeah, they did.
They did. Why do you think?
The closeness, the camaraderie, they just see it's like a guys having fun.
I see. Now, at this moment in your life, you have written many. You write all the time.
I write and I produce.
You produce this Don DeLuise's thing here right now. Tell me about this.
That's a kiddie album or kiddie, children's album
for Don DeLuise.
DeLuise, uh-huh. And we introduced it on Dick Clark's television show.
Uh-huh.
And he did My Favorite Pie's a Pizza Pie,
right.
And he taught them how to make a pizza.
Uh-huh.
And at the end, there was tomato sauce all over the set. It was hilarious.
Uh-huh. Really Don DeLuise is very funny. Now, the Ink Spot, this is the 60th anniversary of the tribute to the Ink Spots.
Tell me about
that.
Well,
you have a song there, too.
Yeah, I do.
You're a producer of this.
That's the sign, right.
Producing. How do you feel by producing nowadays?
I love to work with other singers, and it's fun, and usually before they get in the studio, I'll be rehearsing the songs, so to, you know, tell them how we want it to be heard.
I'm looking at Peggy Lee here. Peggy Lee, you worked with the greatest Peggy Lee. This is at the Copa in
New York City,
and Bernie Allen was on the bill with
That's
you.
Right.
The Four Esquires, look at you guys. God, I can't believe Peggy Lee. Did they have to drag her on stage at the time? Those days, no.
No,
she
not.
She wasn't drunk those days.
No,
I love Peggy Lee.
But you know, that was when she introduced a brand new song, Fever.
That
was the first time, and we were at rehearsal, and we couldn't understand why they were rehearsing her snapping her fingers.
Right.
And they had a spotlight on her finger like this.
Uh-huh.
And at the end of the show, after her final numbers, two young boys came down with a big floral tribute.
Uh-huh.
And it was 7 feet tall, and it was a thermometer having to do with fever.
Fever, of course.
Yes.
Of course. Tell me about dating. You've dated Hedy Lamarr. Come on, Hedy Lamarr, the beauty. Come on,
you know,
young
she
man.
Was, she was really my favorite when I was in the
You're
Army.
Not that tall.
She's, no.
She wasn't tall. Was she tall?
No.
She was smart.
No, she was, yeah.
Was she small, your size?
Little tiny waist. Wait, yes.
Okay, okay.
But I was given a surprise birthday party, or a birthday party with a surprise.
Right.
And they said, don't bring a date, because you have a blind date. And I said, I don't like blind dates.
Uh-huh.
They said, you're going to have one this time.
Uh-huh.
So we were at the party. It was given to me by the two sons of Tony Pastor, the orchestra leader.
Yeah, of course.
And I worked with
He's
Tony
a producer
Pastor.
Too, Tony Pastor.
Yes, right. Yeah. And anyway, one of the brothers left, and they went and said, we're going to pick up your date.
Uh-huh.
So the buzzer, and I go to the door. They said, go to the door. You open the door. So I open the door, and it's Hedy Lamarr.
Uh-huh.
With a cake, and I almost died. But I dated Hedy Lamarr.
Hedy Lamarr,
yeah,
you certainly
right.
did. You can sit
beautiful.
There
and still a beautiful lady.
Bill Courtney.
Yeah.
I love Bill Courtney to sing a song right now. The song that you wrote, What a Town Hollywood Is.
Hollywood, What a Town.
I love Hollywood song. This
yes.
is a great song.
You know, I originally wrote this for Margaret Whiting.
Margaret, yes. You're good friends with her.
I am.
Yeah.
And she needed a closer for her act, and she was going to open at the old, the back lot, cabaret.
In Hollywood. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And she got the song, and I was all excited about it. You know, it was a little bit different than for her, but she said, I don't like some of those lyrics.
Uh-huh.
I said, because she's now become a New Yorker.
Right.
She was
She lives on 58th
raised
Street.
Here. That's
58th
right.
58th Street, where I used
but
to live.
But she said, I don't think I can say, I still remember New York in December because of the cold.
Right, right.
And she said, I don't like that. But anyway, she decided not to do it.
Okay.
And so a little bit later, I rewrote it and did it myself.
Good. I want to hear it. Would you?
Okay.
Yes. Can
Wonderful.
You sing for me?
I'd love,
love
to
hear it.
Sure.
Okay. Let's play the music.
I've spent time in Chicago. New York City once was home. Vacation in New Orleans and by Dallas sure has grown. But there's a place that I have found to be the very best. It's that colorful community there in the Golden West. Life is more fun waking up to the sun in Hollywood.
Hollywood.
And the living is great when you live in the state. That means Hollywood to me. Where else on earth can you get the feeling of summer and spring all the time? There may be some raining, but I'm not complaining, 'cause I still remember New York in December. I get a thrill when I look at the hill that says Hollywood.
Hollywood.
And I come alive up on Mulholland Drive at night. What a sight. There's always a party with music and revelry from out of the beach to shivers. It's an event counting stars in cement in Hollywood.
Hollywood.
And a trip to the strip is the place where you should go. What a show with people who look like they should be in pictures. Sunshine and glamour are permanent fixtures in Hollywood.
Hollywood.
What a town.
About it, I like. Where am I? I like it because I like it the way you sang it, and it makes you feel good.
Thank you. It's a
that
happy
makes
song.
Makes Hollywood feel good. That's old Hollywood. You know, son, that song is a great song. Are you getting any reaction on this song?
It has become the theme of Hollywood Vote, the group that is trying for Hollywood to secede from Los Angeles to become its own town, and they want to make Hollywood Boulevard what it was when I first came here in 45.
Come on, Bill, I was here as a nine-year-old boy. Hollywood will never be Hollywood like we grew up. Come on.
I came here in 45, first time I saw it.
Yeah, but Hollywood, it's not, you know, you came from the military then you came here.
Right.
See, I came as a child. Hollywood was clear, clean, beautiful, wholesome, and it was simple. But it'll never be the same. It's it's too many people, trashy, all kinds of things going on. But look at you here. This is the magazine, Six Hollywood Dates of all the stars and all that.
That's
look
right.
at you here. Wow, Bill. You're right next to, can I get a clip here, sir, please? Hello. Right here.
I was in good company, the Johnny Mathis.
The camera's on. That's the boy. Thank you. There you are. Boy, oh boy, I tell you, that's a good clip of you.
That is. That's when I that's when I went on my own and I signed with RCA Victor.
What has been the difficult in your life, you know, not working with the Four Esquires or, you know,
having to give up music.
What do you mean?
And I went, well,
but you're still singing.
Well, I am now.
Yeah.
But when I left the group, there was a big, it was 2 weeks, it was over.
Right.
Somebody decided they wanted to leave the group.
Who started that? Who's the guy who did that?
It was Wally Gold, who passed away about 2 years ago.
Right.
And Fran Mahoney. Uh-huh. And Fran was from Boston, and Wally was from New York.
Right.
And the leads.
You guys were together a long time.
We were together almost 10 years.
10 years.
And then all of a sudden it was over.
Uh-huh.
And I went and I worked for Billboard magazine. They just took me in to help with a little survey. I was a friend of a friend
uh-huh.
got me the job. And I did the survey, and then someone asked me to stay. And I was there almost 5 years, and I ended up the assistant to the general manager.
What have you learned? What have you learned, Bill Courtney, about yourself, about life? What have you learned?
That I can do anything I put my mind to. I came out here 28 years ago to take over an art gallery.
Right.
Now, I liked art. And when I got out of the Army, I worked in a store, so I was pretty good at selling.
Right.
But I took over an art gallery. And I knew nothing about framing and that type of thing. And I became a specialist designing plexiglass presentations,
right.
Framing and picking art. Yep. And I had lots and lots of celebrities. I did all the framing for Cher, let's see, Sandy Duncan, on and on and on.
If you had to do it over again, let me tell you, if you have to do it over again, Bill Courtney,
mm-hmm.
you know, four guys,
mm-hmm.
with being a group, you have four different minds, different mentalities.
That's right.
You're not alone.
I know.
Would you do it again that way?
I would rather have done it as a single performer.
Because it's difficult to do it with someone else, am I right?
Well, I was offered to go out as a single. I was at the Celebrity Club in Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
Dick Clark came in with some record people, and our manager was there.
Uh-huh.
And they asked if they could sign me away from the group. And I said, no, I can't. We're too much together. Mm-hmm. It was wonderful. Then I loved singing, you know, four parts. Uh-huh. And I love, you know.
Are you satisfied what's happening right now with Bill Courtney's life right now?
Right now?
Yeah, because are you?
I am.
You are. You're not
because
bitter. You're not.
Not bitter. At all. Not at all.
Because there's a lot of groups that split up
mm-hmm.
are bitter. Now, the greatest singing group to me, I worked with them, it was the Everly Brothers, Phil and Don.
Yes.
The greatest, purest singing group ever.
We traveled.
Two
we
boys.
Did a tour with them,
yeah.
Yes.
I loved, they split up. I worked with them when they split up up in Orange County. Broke his guitar backstage, the whole thing. I worked in Germany with them. I worked in France. We did all the military shows. These two guys are the greatest
mm-hmm.
singers. They're back together again. They split up for 10 years, you know.
Yes, I do.
Jack Rale handled them. Jack Rale, the manager. And he also handled Patti Page.
Married her.
Jack Rale never
Didn't
married
he?
Her. No,
oh.
no. Jack Rale never married Patti Page. Patti Page married a milkman who owned milk companies. But they live in San Diego.
Yeah.
But Jack Rale was the manager, and he got 50% of everything that Patti Page got. 50%.
Oh.
But not 50% of the Everly Brothers,
right.
See? And those two guys, to me, as a group, the best in the world.
Beautiful sound.
Yeah. Do you have another song you're going to say?
Well, what
I
brought
just a
to
little
show
bit.
You.
Yeah?
I have a little bit of a song. Now, this is
what?
40 years ago.
40 years ago?
40
I'd
years
love to hear
ago.
Real
first
quick.
Song I did for RCA Victor.
Okay, let's hear it. Please. Bill Courtney. Hit it. working on the Ed Sullivan Show. Tell me about working on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Well, when we worked with Peggy Lee at the Copacabana, we were there for 2 weeks, and someone came in on opening night, and they asked if we would do the show. We did it the Sunday night between the 2 weeks we were at the Copa.
Right.
And that was the number one show, variety show on television, and it was so exciting.
Just who was on the show that day? You remember, do you?
Kate Smith.
Did she sing God Bless America that day?
I don't remember whether she did or not.
She was great. She was the greatest God Bless America ever.
Wonderful.
We need her today to do it. We really need her today. Mm. Tell me about Sarah Vaughan. You work with Sarah Vaughan, one of the greatest. I have two. She is absolutely the greatest.
We work with at the Town Casino.
In Buffalo. For Harry Altman.
That's right.
And the Glen, and too. Yeah, the summer resort called the Glen.
Right.
Yes.
And Florine Zabak was also on the bill.
Right.
But she was naturally the closing act.
Uh-huh.
She came out. They would not let her leave. No matter what she sang, applause, standing ovation.
Yeah.
Finally, she went over to the piano player, and she came back, and she sang the Lord's Prayer like you have never heard it before, and you can't follow that up. Then she left.
You know something of those days of the clubs? They had a line of girls opening the show. Oh, with supper clubs. These were called supper clubs. We don't have them in America anymore.
No.
They're
Vegas.
Very rare. Vegas.
That's it.
That was different. I'm talking about that was totally different. We have a line of girls and the comedians and the acts. And it was a
dance
great
teams.
Dance teams and jugglers and all kinds of wonderful entertainers. It was great.
It was wonderful.
I was thinking of today working with you all those days back in 45 years ago.
That's right.
I'll tell you, looking at you, you just brought me back. Woo! Memories, totally memories of those wonderful showbiz.
Right.
So you had a good time then.
I had a wonderful time. And traveling, you meet so many people, and then you go back 6 months later to another club, and they're in the audience.
Yeah, writing a book.
Wonderful.
Because I have a book right now. It's called The Boy with the Betty Grable Legs, and it's
out now.
And guess what? I have a billboard on Sunset. On Sunset and somewhere on Sunset, you'll see it.
One of those big
billboards, yes.
Ah.
And it's great. Some lady's doing it for me. I don't know why, but she's just doing it for
me. She loves your legs.
But you know, you should do a book about singing groups, about how tough it was, how lovely it was, whatever.
Well,
because I'm sure you've had some tough times on the road with four guys.
Yeah, we did.
Different mentalities. And I'm telling you, the Four Esquires, I'll never forget them. They were great.
I was just waiting out here, and I looked at the sign. It said, The Green Room.